All right, so today I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit about in my lab that involves neuroimaging and some of the questions that we try and answer in my lab. So basically what we're interested in is understanding how incentives influence performance. And those incentives can vary greatly. They can be social incentives or monetary incentives. But today I'm going to tell you about the case in which really large monetary incentives can lead to poor performance. So to give an example of this, we can look at this video. So this is Roberto Baggio in the 1994 World Cup. And if he scores his penalty kick, they win the World Cup. If he misses, they lose. And he did really, so he's got a great ponytail. But aside from that, he couldn't even put it on the net, right? So he's practiced this thousands upon thousands of times. At the time, he was the best professional soccer player in the world. But why is it that he's not able to perform under pressure? And so today, I'm going to tell you about some studies that we did in the lab to sort of look at this phenomenon in the case of large monetary incentives, so large stakes for money. And we'll try and see what's happening in the brain that causes these things to occur. Okay? So in economics, it's widely assumed that increasing incentives increase performance up until a point. So here you see on the x-axis performance, whether that's increased effort or increased motivation, and incentive from low to high. And so the thinking is that as you increase incentives, better and better in your performance, and then when they get really high, you sort of asymptote and you reach the ceiling of your performance and stabilize. But what's been found in the wild, in real life, is that as incentives increase, you do get better and better, but in certain cases, you can actually do worse. So that, you know, we call this choking under pressure, right? And so there were studies that were done by Dan Ariely, who's an economist at Duke, where he went to India and he paid people percentages of their yearly income to do certain tasks. Their motor tasks, working memory tasks, spatial reasoning tasks. And he found that across those skilled tasks, as incentives increased, people got better and better, but for really high incentives, people tended to actually do worse, okay? But it really isn't known why. What was thought was that it was over-motivation. So you tend to be over-motivated, whatever that means. So people have sort of adopted these classical psychology ideas of, well, you know, you give more incentive, you become over-motivated, maybe that causes increase in arousal, and that causes you to choke under pressure. So while there's some psychological understanding of why these things occur, or thought as to why these things occur, it isn't really understood what happens in the brain when you're performing poorly under pressure, and how that leads to these decreases in performance, okay? So what we want to do in our study, and what we want to do in some of the experiments in my lab, is sort of understand why this occurs. And so what we did was we put people in the MRI scanner and we sort of looked at this area of the brain, the ventral striatum in blue, which is made up of nucleus accumbens and the ventral parts of putamen. And this area of the brain is thought to encode reward values. So as you give people more reward, this area of the brain lights up with increasing monetary rewards. It's also involved in instrumental performance for reward. So if you're reaching to get something that's rewarding, you find that ventral striatal activity increases the more rewarding that option is. And it's thought to sort of be this interface between reward values and instrumental performance. So this area sort of invigorates the behavioral performance that you have. So as I said before, it encodes rewards and punishments. So if you just simply show rewards to people, you get increasing activations in ventral striatum. It regulates instrumental motor responses. So if you're just reaching for different things, you'll find that ventral striatum will activate more for more rewarding items. And it mediates the effects of rewards on increases in motor effort. Okay, so we thought that this might be a place where we should look at why your motor performance is degrading for large incentives, okay? And so we wanted to ask, what are the neural mechanisms underlying paradoxical performance for incentives? So we needed to create a task that was novel to subjects and had standardized difficulty levels, right? So we wanted to make sure that we could bring people into the MRI scanner, have them do a task that was novel to people so that they didn't have some prior expertise that could make them do better or worse than others, and we could have some standard way of assessing people's performance across different individuals. And so what we did was we brought people in, we had them do a movement task, and we tracked their movements with some motion tracking cameras. So these are basically like the equivalent of like a Xbox Kinect. So somebody has a marker on their finger, they make reaching movements, we're able to track them with these cameras. And the task that we have them do was control of a spring mass system. So basically, they saw two cursors, one corresponding to their hand position, another corresponding to a mass, and these were attached via a spring. They began with both of these targets in this X position, and as they moved, the mass sort of oscillated about their hand cursor. And so this was a very novel task to people. They're not used to doing this, right? And so the idea was that since it was could train them up from the beginning and see how they learn, and then get people at standardized difficulty levels and incentivize them and see how that affects their performance. So to give you an idea of the way things looked, we had them do these trials where they had 2 seconds to move both of these cursors into a target. It flashed green if they were successful, and they just repeated this 500 times. So the way it looks is this yellow cursor is the mass cursor, there'll be a white cursor that's the hand, and they'll sort of try and move their hand into that target, and you can see they're really bad at it at first. And then as they practice after learning, they get really good at it and they're able to skillfully move into those targets, okay? Do you kind of understand the task? And so we have, we basically trained them over a series of 500 trials, so it was pretty challenging for them. So you see trial number and performance on the y-axis. So they get better and better as they train, and there's a significant increase in their performance after training. And then after that, we vary the target size with which they're trying to put those cursors in. And so that allows us to get some standardized assessment of how successful they are at different difficulty levels, right? So smaller target sizes will be more difficult than larger ones. And you can see data from that phase here. So this is the size of the targets versus the percent performance on the y-axis. You can see that as the target size increases, it gets easier and easier for people to perform. And we basically set some standard difficulty levels, a hard difficulty level, which was 60% performance, and an easy difficulty level, which is 80% performance, okay? So does that make sense, everybody, thus far? And then what we did was we had them come in, we put them in the MRI scanner, and we had them perform this task for reward. So we had trials that varied in reward from $0 to $100. So they'd see what they were playing for. So in this case, this person's playing for $50. If they're successful putting both of these cursors into the target, they'll get $50. They see the outcomes, and we repeat this over the range of incentives from $0 to $100. Now the trick that we did was we only randomly extracted one trial, so we don't need to pay them over all trials, and that way we don't need to distribute money over everybody, right? Over all these trials. We're not paying them hundreds of dollars, we're only paying them once, but it's in their best interest to do their best in all trials because they don't know which trial will be randomly selected. Okay? Does that make sense? And so here you see some behavioral data. So this is the incentive. So we had incentive levels ranging from $0 to $100. And then we have the incentive resulting in peak performance. And so basically what you can see is that people's peak performance at the different difficulty levels and different incentive levels are all over the place. It's very variable, okay? The incentive at which they tend to have peak performance, all right? But if we sort of collapse into low, medium, and high levels of incentives, so low being $0 to $5, medium being $25, $50, $75, and high being $100, you see in the easy case, people's performance increases with increasing incentive, but in the hard case, it increases and then significantly drops off for large incentives, okay? So basically we're able to, in the hard case, we're able to replicate this choking effect for large incentives when tasks are very difficult, okay? Does anybody have any? Yeah. We defined it because it as the highest, because it was the highest incentive we offered. But you could think that there is, you know, that's arbitrary in some way, because you can think that your, you know, what you see as high is in reference to the incentives offered to you. So, you know, if I were giving you incentives from $0 to $10, maybe 10 could be as high as well. So there are these ideas of reference dependent effects of value. Here we just defined it as 100 because that was the maximum that we offered. Yeah. Are there any other questions? Okay. So we replicated this choking effect for the hard condition, and then what we wanted to know is what's happening in the brain when people are choking under pressure. So we had people do this in the scanner, so we could actually look at brain activity associated with processing incentives while they're performing these tasks. So we took fMRI scans that allowed us to get whole brain activations, basically partitioning the entire brain into a series of volume elements, or voxels. Each of these voxels generates a time course of activity, or of bold signal. And then we can basically just do a regression where we look at different task conditions and look at how those task conditions are related to the neural activity. We can use the regressors from this general linear model to create like brain activations in certain regions in the brain. Okay, so in our case, we had a general linear model that looked like this. We modeled the time of presentation as a function of the levels of incentives. So we wanted to look at where in the brain was activating or deactivating at the time of incentive presentation with increasing incentive. We could also look at the time of the motor task itself on trials in which somebody was successful and they scored, or unsuccessful and they missed, as a function of increasing or decreasing incentive. Okay? So we were looking at incentive presentation, what parts of the brain were active or deactivated with increasing incentive, and at the time of the motor task, what areas of the brain were active or deactivated with increasing incentive, okay? And so the thing that we thought might happen because of this over-motivation hypothesis that a lot of people have is that, well, maybe we'd find in ventral striatum, those people that were more motivated would have increasing activations in ventral striatum when they were performing that task. So maybe they'd have steeper activations. You'd have steeper activations for increasing incentives when you were one of the people that choked under pressure. Okay. So we looked at the time of incentive presentation in this area of the brain, the ventral striatum. Here you see percent signal change from in ventral striatum from the imaging analysis over the different incentive levels. And you can see that as incentive levels increased at the time of incentive presentation, you had increasing activation in ventral striatum. So this is sort of exactly what has been shown before and that we discussed before, that increasing incentives result in increasing activity in ventral striatum. But then what we saw that was a little bit weird was that at the time of the motor task itself, the same area of ventral striatum deactivates for increasing incentives. Okay. So initially we just sort of ignored this idea and we thought that we'd have this increasing activity for increasing incentives during incentive presentations, and the extent of this increase would be related to your choking under pressure. So let's test that. So what we did was we created a measure of neural sensitivity to incentive, basically the slope between increasing incentive and the percent signal change in ventral striatum. So the steeper that slope, the more steeply you'll encode incentives, right? And we can do that at the time of incentive presentation and the motor task, but we began by just focusing on incentive presentation. So here you see performance at the $100 incentive. So remember, people tend to, on average, choke at that $100 incentive level. And neural sensitivity to incentive on the y-axis. So what you might expect to see here is that the more neural sensitivity to incentive you have, if it was this over-motivation idea, the more the decreased performance.